Hey now, Rodney R. Dixon here, and this is the review of the Kyocera Rise Android smartphone. Let's begin with specifications. Now, I obtain all specifications when I can from a site called Geekaphone, GeekaPhone.com. I find they give the most comprehensive and most detailed specs. Okay, so here we go with the Kyocera Rise. It's an Android 4.0 ice cream sandwich. It features 3G, 1X EVDV, Rev-D, 5 Mbps. It has a keyboard and a numeric keypad, QWERTY keyboard, physical numerical keypad. It's a 3.5-inch screen, 164 ppi, 480 by 320 resolution. It's a capacitive touchscreen. And it has a 1.0 GHz single-core processor. It was released August 2012. I believe it is distributed by Virgin Mobile in the States and Public Mobile in Canada. LCD screen, 3.5 inch, 480 by 320 resolution, capacitive. Screen PPI is only 164. The weight, 157 grams, which is heavy. It's actually kind of a heavy phone. The thickness is 14 millimeters. The size is 60 by 111 by 14 millimeters. As mentioned, it has a physical numeric keypad with QWERTY keyboard. It is not waterproof. It has a 1000 megahertz processor, single core. It has 524 megs of RAM, 2 gigs of internal storage, and it supports microSD. It has assisted GPS. It has an accelerometer. It has a compass. It has a 3.5mm headphone jack. The camera is but 3.2 megapixels on the back. It does have a flash. No secondary camera. The browser benchmark is 898ms. It does support Adobe Flash. The generation is 3G. The network supported is 1X EVDV, Rev-D, 5 Mbps. CDMA, 0.014 Mbps. Download speed, 1.1 Mbps. Upload speed, 0.56 Mbps. Network latency is 250 ms. Wi-Fi, it supports 802.11n standard at 150 Mbps. Wi-Fi hotspot, yes. Talk time, 8.3 hours. Standby time, 6.9 days. And there you go. That is the breakdown. Let's continue with the actual review of the device. We'll do a quick tour on the front fascia. Well, first of all, you have the 3.5 inch screen. You have a charge indicator light. Here is the earpiece, which is a small little fingernail indent. You have your back button, your home button, your Windows button, and your menu or settings button. Now you may note that these buttons are in a different order than most, for example, Samsung Android smartphones. And this, especially if you're used to the old format, the old layout, is incredibly frustrating when you're trying to get anything done. I often will try to tap one of the soft buttons in order to, for example, bring up the menu, and because menu is now here and back is now here, I end up backing out of my application. On the top, 3.5 millimeter 1/8 inch stereo audio mini jack. You have your sleep wake button, excuse me. You have your loudspeaker on the back. You have your volume controls here. You have your micro USB form factor connector. The microphone is hidden. Can't find it. The microphone hole, if you will. Here's a shutter button on the side. Here's a tab to remove the back cover. The micro SD slot is located under the back cover, so you gotta lean up the back cover to get the micro SD card slot. On the rear fascia, it has a metal flake gunmetal paint on it. It's just paint. It's actually very thin plastic. You have your 3.2 megapixel camera with LED flash. Kyocera indicated. Embossed is Qualcomm 3G CDMA. Important to note, this is a CDMA phone. It doesn't take a SIM card. It is manufactured and formatted isn't the right word. It's configured to work only on one carrier, so you buy it for one carrier and it works on one carrier. I believe that covers the tour, and of course you have the slide-out QWERTY keyboard, which I haven't used the slide-out QWERTY keyboard in some time. The last time I did so was probably an LG Neon or a Samsung Vice, and these are, you know, standard cell phones. These are not smartphones. And, yeah, I gotta say I missed it, especially the layout of this one is very convenient, very good. More on that later. So, let's begin with the boot-up procedure. See how long it takes to boot the phone. Here you go. Still waiting for it to boot. Now I do have some apps installed right now. I have Text Plus and Fongo installed, so Fongo will open up. Okay, let me log out of Fongo real quick. Sorry about that. Okay, very good. So, from the home screen, you have of course various home screens that you can configure. You always have a section that is dedicated specifically to opening your app menu. You have this widget. Now, I'm used to these controls being available in the notifications. They are not available in the notification section of the Android 4.0 Ice Cream Sandwich operating system. And because of that, you have to have a widget, which can be a little confusing at first, but when you use it a lot, it's a good thing. For example, turn off Wi-Fi on and off, turn off Bluetooth on and off, turn on GPS on and off, rotate screen on and off, and brightness from no brightness, well, lowest brightness, 50%, and 100%, which is very useful, and automatic to use the light sensor. Which is very useful when you are driving about, for example, and using the GPS, and you can't see the GPS in the sunlight. Please hold. Sorry, it's allergy season. Okay, so after that interruption, I should say, the phone features what's known as Eco Mode. And Eco Mode is actually really, really interesting. What you could do in Eco Mode is you could set a sleep timer for your device to go to sleep. You can change the display brightness, for example. I could decrease the brightness, and this adds a leaf to my Eco level counter. You could change the wallpaper, the standby screen to the Eco wallpaper, which I was doing for a long time before I actually inserted a micro SD card. Took a photo, a low-resolution photo of just blackness by putting the phone to my belly and taking a photo of my belly, and now it's my belly on the screen, although in black. And that's a good thing, because that obviously saves power and saves resources. And auto-sync, you could turn off auto-sync, so, for example, Gmail does not update automatically, which is important. So that is a good feature. Just finding out how I should handle this. I guess I will continue with the settings. Well, let me start with the front end or the home screens. When trying to place icons, I don't know if you're seeing those outlines in the screen, but you have very limited space. Now, the reason for that is largely because this widget takes up so much space. Right now I have 12 slots available to me because this widget is taking up 4 slots, and you have 16 slots for apps on each home screen, which I find a little limited. It's probably due to this huge app button in the middle, which is unfortunate. Oh no, now it's not just an app button, it's also a... you could also put apps in here, apps that will remain on every home screen. I apologize. So it's actually not that bad, considering that you could put things like settings, that in my case I use very often, right there on that bar. I forgot about that. Okay, very good. Can I move this guy? No, I can't. He must stay there. The application feature. Okay, in settings, we'll go into settings right now. You have Wi-Fi off and on. That was silly of me. I didn't mean to turn it off and on, but I wanted to see if there was another option. Bluetooth off and on. Data usage. You can monitor data usage. You can set a mobile data monitor, data statistics, and it can warn you when you're when you've used a certain amount of data, and it could actually turn off data transfer after another point. So you could set a warning point and a transfer point, which is very good. Sound is all your standard stuff. Display, brightness, wallpaper, auto-rotate, sleep. The longest sleep you could set is 30 minutes of inactivity. Keyboard timeout. What's nice about this is you could set a different timeout compared to the screen. Please hold. For example, right now my screen timeout is 30 minutes, but that wouldn't make sense for the keyboard. You see, the keyboard lights up, it's backlit. Why would I want the keyboard lit up for 30 minutes? It doesn't make sense. The screen makes sense, you're looking at the screen all the time. The keyboard, you only need to see the light, the backlight of the keyboard when you're using it, and thus, you could set a different keyboard timeout, which is very useful. Storage. Internal storage, you got a breakdown. It says 1 gig's available, which is strange because it's supposed to be 2 gigs. But, no, total space is 1 gig, I'm sorry. Apps are taking up 139 megs, and available space is 780 megs, apparently. Battery, you have a breakdown of the battery, what's taking up the most juice, what's running, and all programs. When you tap on them here, what's nice about this is you could force stop them just out of this screen, which I like that. Force stop. Now here's the question, do they really stop? Because I don't see this updating itself. Easy Wi-Fi apparently is a system by which you can set the phone to find and connect Wi-Fis in your area very easily. No, I don't know. Oh, wait, refresh. Maybe that's why. Yeah, no, it does work. Very good. So YouTube for stop. Google Play, will I go in it? Probably not, for stop. So that's running. What's taking up battery most? That is very useful. It's a good thing. I totally forgot about that functionality. Oops, I didn't want to go into apps yet. PC connection. Default connection type. Here's the thing. You have charge only, mass storage, and media transfer. I didn't play with media transfer because I'm not going to install software just to transfer and sync data. Charge only, obviously it does charge, and mass storage. You could only use the mass storage function if you have an installed micro SD card. Otherwise, mass storage will never be available to you. Please hold. All right. You could set it to ask you whenever the USB connection type. You could set the phone to ask you about USB connection type whenever you connect the phone to a PC. Here's the apps breakdown. Now you have it separated, downloaded on SD card, and running. Under running, you can also switch to show cached processes. And what's appreciated in cached processes, now you can't do this for all apps, but for many apps, it's not showing me them anymore. Oh, maybe I shut down the... that's too bad. Gallery. Oh, that's too bad. I wanted to show you something that I found very useful. Anyway, there is a function by which you can set certain apps to never load which I haven't seen prior on different Android platforms. Now, is it in cached processes or running services? That's the question. Unfortunately, I don't have anything that would give you such a a option. Just looking around, hoping I find one. No, that's too bad. I want to show you that. Anyway, suffice to say, there are certain apps. It's not for all apps, for example. Yeah, no. Well, nonetheless, not too bad. Right now it's running in memory. I mean, I could tolerate all of this. But there is means by which you can set certain apps to never run, which is nice. But only certain ones, not all. Counts in sync. Okay, we know that. I gotta put you on hold again. I'm sorry. Please hold. Has to be the first video I ever shoot where I'm blowing my nose on video. Sorry about that. Location services. You could turn on location services and GPS satellites. GPS satellites uses the assisted GPS. Google's location services uses Wi-Fi, not hotspots, but how could I put that? Wi-Fi signals around you. Now, the phone doesn't need to connect to these Wi-Fi signals. Basically, just by judging the signal strength, it can help in pinpointing where you are. Security. You could turn off screen lock, which I love. Oh, wow. I wish Android 2 had this. For example, phone's off. I want to see what's happening on my phone. Turn it on. Boom. Right back in my operating system. I don't have to do a pattern or slide something. I love that. Make passwords visible. Device administrator. Apparently, you can encrypt data. But in order to do so, you need to charge your battery enough and keep your phone plugged in to start encryption. I have no need to encrypt my data. I'm the only one who uses it. Allow installation of non-market apps. Okay. There's trusted credentials. Install from SD card. Where was I? That was security. Language and input. Language, English, Canada, spelling. You have what's called, well, you have Android keyboard, and you have what's called, you have swipe. I shouldn't exclude swipe just because I don't use it. And you have Google Voice typing. Now, I'm a huge fan of Google Voice Search. What Google Voice Search does, I mean, sure, it allows you to search by speaking aloud search criteria. Big whoop, that's nice. Even the iPhone 4 can do that, and the iPhone 4 doesn't have speech-to-text. But what Google Voice Search also allows you to do is conduct speech-to-text. So if I'm typing out an email, I don't have to type out the email or tap out the email. I could literally speak the email and it will take my voice and transfer it into text that it will print out. The difference between Google Voice typing and the Google Voice search functionality is the Google Voice search functionality does it in blocks. So in Google Voice search, I would activate the system, and I would say, "Hey there, how have you been?" Question mark, and then I'd stop, and then you'd have a block of text. Hey there, how have you been? The voice search function would turn off. I'd have to type it, tap it again to once again continue my next sentence. I have been fine, period, and then it'll print out, "I have been fine, period." The way Google Voice typing works, and oh wow, what an innovation! I love it so much. The microphone functionality of the speech-to-text engine will stay on. And during the time, you could say, "Hi there." "Hi there" will show up, and it will wait for more. Comma, I'll put in a comma. "How have you been?" It'll put in, "How have you been?" Question mark, it'll put in a question mark. And it'll stay as such, continually taking your voice and typing out the words you say. What's even better is, of course, Google speech-to-text, like all speech recognition engines, isn't perfect. For example, maybe it's my Canadian accent, I don't know, but when I say comma, sometimes I do comma, I say it quickly, comma, and it'll write K-A-M-A instead of making a comma. And if it does that, I have a button by which I could just tap it, and it'll undo that word. It'll delete that specific word. It's really brilliant. It works great. That alone, aside, well, in addition to the slide-out QWERTY keyboard, makes this telephone a great communication tool. I was, of course, always a big fan of Android phones, but this one, for those two functionalities, it's immeasurable how useful it is. Moving on. Backup and reset. I can back up my data and factory reset the phone. Date and time. All the standard automatic date and time, automatic time zone, use 24 hours, set date. Accessibility. Need a screen reader? No. But anyway. No services installed. Large text, power button ends call, auto-rotate, speak passwords. Touch and hold delay short. I like that. What touch and hold delay means is if I want to, let's say, grab one of my icons and move it, I could elect that my held down icon before I can move it takes little time before I can start moving it, medium time or a lot of time. Short, medium, or long. I really like that. Install web scripts. We don't care. Developer options. Developer options on this phone are interesting. USB debugging. Doesn't matter. Well, I don't use it. Stay awake. Allow mock locations. Desktop backup password. I don't know about that. Strict mode enabled. Flash screen when apps do long operations on main thread. It lets you know. Pointer location. Screen overlay showing current touch data. Show touches. Show visual feedback for touches. Show screen updates. Flash areas of the screen when they update. Show CPU usage. Screen overlay showing current CPU usage. Force GPU rendering. Use 2D hardware acceleration in applications. Window animation scale. I turned that off. Transition animation scale. I turned that off. And here's where it gets really interesting with apps. Don't keep activities. Destroy every activity as soon as the user leaves it. What that means is, let's say, for example, I'm in Google Maps. And for anybody who's used Google Maps in Android, they'll know that it's almost questionable how it retains data even when you leave the app. For example, on an Android 2 device, I could use Google Maps. It'll map out a location, let's say. Leave Google Maps, clear my memory, clear my cache, kill Google Maps, and then open up Google Maps, and everything is as if the program was always there and always running. What this does, don't keep activities, is as soon as I leave Google Maps, it'll flush out any data that was present there. And when I go back, it's like I'm restarting the program. I don't have it activated because, yes, it's extremely useful if you're running but one app at a time. Let's say you want to play a game, you want as many resources as possible. You put that on, you play your game, good, good, good. However, the problem is for multitasking, and I forget this. Like, for example, if I'm typing out SMS text, then I want to go to my email to check something and then go back to my SMS text because I was referring to something in my email, I'll lose my position in each because it always flushes out any data present on the screen every time I switch apps. But nevertheless, a good function to have, just not useful when you're multitasking. Background process limit. This is the other brilliant, brilliant functionality. I'll come back to it. There's also show all app not responding dialog for background apps. So when apps are running in the background, it'll let you know if they're not responding. Background process limit. This is so great, especially considering that I'm not, the one thing I gotta say I was never a fan of Android is how many things can load in the background, stay in the background, and even when you shut them down, they keep on coming back. What's nice about this, I'm sorry, I'm spitting a lot. It has to do with the heat. It's, by the way, it's an extremely hot and humid day where I am right now. Okay. No, it could also be the allergies, too. I'm all stuffed up. I'm all congested. Background process limit. What I can do is I could turn off all background processes. Let me show you an example. Apps running show cached processes. This is everything that's running in the back that's cached. Why is it running? Ah, just in case you need it. You know, that's fun. Yeah, a little load quicker. Of course, it's taking up memory. It's taking up resources. I don't want all this stuff running. So what I could do is go into developer. Background process limit. I could set it to 4 processes, 3 processes, 2 processes, 1 process, or no background processes, which is brilliant. Now all of a sudden, let's see what's running in background. Running. Show cached. Launcher. That's all that's running. Oh, Google Play comes. But don't worry. It kills it right away. It does it for you, which is great. It's so awesome. Unfortunately, you can't use this functionality with... See, things keep on trying to come back. They want to come back. They want to be there. They want to run. But no. Background process limit will say, no, you do not. Which is brilliant. Problem is, some apps absolutely need it. For example, Text Plus. Text Plus, you can't run Text Plus if it can't open up that background process. So in which case, what you can do is to ensure that things don't get out of hand and you got background processes for everything and nothing and things you'll never need, is you can change it. Where was I? Was it in here? Yes, it was. I could set the process limit to like 1 process or 2 processes. So it'll allow, for example, Text Plus to run when I'm using Text Plus, but it won't allow things like, easy Wi-Fi, Facebook, things I never use, Google Plus stuff, you know, it gets rid of that. Oh, on that subject, it's a good thing I mentioned Google Plus. Of course, I'll have to put you on hold. I apologize. Please hold. Okay. This phone has a lot of Google Plus integration. Now, is the Google Plus integration because of Kyocera? I'm pretty sure it's because of Google and their association with Android. What's nice is you can get rid of it. As you saw, there's no traces of Google Plus, which is good. Just when you start up, it's kind of annoying how it's all there and it's always trying to run. Same thing with a Facebook app. A Facebook app's always in the background. I don't use it. I don't want it, but it's there. About phone, can I show this? Okay, yes I can. Got status, legal information, UL environment, model number rise, Android 4.004, software, blah, 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 blah. It doesn't matter, you don't care about that. And you have system update. And the way system update works is update Kyocera software provides the latest Android and firmware updates. So you could tap on that and apparently it updates Windows new firmware. Last I checked, there was no new firmware. Okay, so you have 2 browsers. You have the standard Android browser and you have Google Chrome. I prefer the standard Android browser to Google Chrome. Let's see what it opens here. Here, I set it to about blank. Let me show you how this works. Let's go to a page. I don't have the microphone available. Oh, yes, I do. I'm sorry. Not used to seeing it up there. Or it was there. Anywho. Yahoo. It'll go to Google to find Yahoo. Okay. That makes sense. That's one thing that's not too fun about those quick searches sometimes. It'll have a result that's like, oh, yeah, that's what I want. And you'll tap on it, and guess what? It brings you to another page. Okay, now what's nice about this browser is in both cases you have functionalities by which you can... Oh, and the inventor of the mouse passed away. It's terrible. Anywho, yeah, but he lived a good life, 88. Okay, so, where was I? Yeah. What you can do is you always have the option. It's not there. You always have the option here to request desktop site. And apparently when you tap it, it will automatically go to the desktop variant, as you see here, which is good, very good. For the most part, it works really well. There's some exceptions where it doesn't seem to work, but nonetheless. What else can I show you? Yeah, bookmarks, save for offline reading. You could save pages so that they remain on the phone and you can then view them offline. I'm pretty confident that is requires, as everything that requires saving on this phone, requires an SD card. Settings. Could choose form autofill, could choose autofill text. Anything that's worth mentioning? Remember form data, that's good. It's all standard stuff. You could force zoom text scaling. You could enable JavaScript. You could enable plugins, which is great because this phone does support Adobe Flash, but it doesn't come with it. Now, I've created a how-to video on how to install Adobe Flash. You should see an annotation in the video right now, which you can go view. So yeah, enable plugins. You could enable plugins by which point Flash will function. Default zoom, open pages and overview, block pop-ups, all standard stuff. I went into here. You have bandwidth management, which is nice. Search result preload. No, actually, it's not that nice. I think that's a misnomer to use a bandwidth management. Load images and search result preloading. You could have the browser preload high confidence search results, which I turn off. It's on by default. Quick controls, full screen. Okay. What was I getting to? Yes, Flash. This browser does support Flash. Let me show you how tabs work. There you go. You tap that button, and you could either add new tabs. So you have many tabs. And you see you shut them down with the little X. What I'm not happy about is I've already dealt with Android browsers, which when you close the only present window, it either shows nothing, just a blank canvas where you could add tabs or add windows, or it will open up a new window automatically. On this one, it shuts down the browser, which I'm not thrilled with, but anyway. First things first, let me... Okay, that should be fine, hopefully. Let me go to watch.ctv.ca. Why am I going to watch.ctv.ca is because I want to show you how the Flash player functions on this phone. I find it sad. This phone has more RAM than my Samsung Galaxy W. It has the same processor. Okay, this is a bad example because this is a commercial for the source, and this commercial is coded in a low resolution, so it works rather okay. Anyway, but what I was getting to is that on my Samsung Galaxy W, I can stream CTV video, and it streams just fine. On this phone, when I try to stream CTV video, it's as if it refuses to skip any frame. So the video will not only be choppy and frame by frame, but the sound will have a rippling effect. So if I were saying, for example, it's a sunny day outside, it would play on this phone as, it's a sunny day. And it's unfortunate that way. I'm not sure why a phone with better specs runs the Adobe Flash Player worse than my phone with slightly lower specs. And this phone also has a lower resolution screen, so I figured there wouldn't be as much processing needed. However, on my 800x480 display Samsung Galaxy W, plays video much better. I should note that playing video on globaltv.com worked a lot better. And this is the other thing that happens. On this phone, for some reason, watch.ctv.ca, video regularly just freezes, and it'll never come back. There's no way to bring it back. It's really unfortunate. You'll notice that each time, by the way, every time I was trying to move the window, what do? I grab outside the frame, because if you grab the inside, can't do it. Uh-oh. Ah, it brings me That's probably why it works so poorly. It wants to integrate a clickable link in there in the video. Okay. Use both TextPlus and Fongo on it. TextPlus worked great, even with the addition of this QWERTY keyboard. It works even better because, as I mentioned, keyboard layout is very intuitive. Look what I'm doing right now. I'm touching the keyboard. I'm not worried about, you know, accidentally typing, because you do have to actually key press in order for the keystrokes to work. I found that the space has a dead spot. Like, if you get it on an angle, get it with a fingernail, it doesn't work so much. You got to really get that thumb on there, which is unfortunate. Here is the quick breakdown. Well, that's cool. You have the arrow keys. I never really used them in this respect. Pretty nifty. Never used the arrow keys. Never think to. You have a quick function for .com, which is so great. I hate typing out .com when it's right there. That's great. Functions for your numbers. I find the placement of the numbers are hard to get, especially if you're typing out a phone number. Then all of a sudden you gotta like hold function. It's like you gotta get right under that ledge. I have small hands, so for me it's difficult. I can imagine somebody with big hands, it would probably be really difficult. That ledge is in the way. But nonetheless, a great keyboard. Okay. That was browser. Email. Let me do this off camera in case there's any confidential information. It's updating. Let's see if I could load this. Okay, so unlike my Samsung Galaxy W, the email app actually allows me to not only receive my email, as the Samsung Galaxy W does, but it also allows me to send email through my Yahoo, which is very good. I'm happy. The email layout, what's nice about it is automatically they block pictures to save on bandwidth necessarily, but download times, which is nice, and you could elect to show pictures. What I don't like about it is that you can't pinch zoom any further than what you see. So for example, right now, trying to view this ad from the brick, I gotta scroll around all over the place. Also, the email app doesn't support tilting. I just want to get a landscape view. Why won't it work? That's because you have to slide out the keyboard, which is silly, but it's the way it is. There you go, see, it's so. Ooh, hot buy. Anyway, you have the functionality to next message, previous, delete. You can flag messages. You could reply all, and forward. All of them function. I've tried all of them. You could go back to your inbox. Let me try a reply to the brick. Oh, that'll be fun. Compose email. Why am I composing email? I'm hoping I can show you. Well, I could show you the typing on here. Hi there, the brick. Oh, it's been so long. I love this. How have you been, friend? That's cool. I like that. It works really good, as mentioned. You can use the arrows to shuttle between characters. That's so useful. Instead of tapping and then getting that little cursor that you gotta drag around, you have arrows. Oh, I love it. Love it so much. Let's see if I could show you the, I forget what it's called, the voice typing. So, comma. Hey, see, it did call me. But it underlines what was the last thing, so I could tap on it and choose delete. Unfortunately, now it was going out of, out of control, because I was explaining something on camera. Comma. It won't do comma. Like I was saying, what I was saying. All right, maybe it doesn't work so good. I don't know. I had good results before. That's pretty accurate, if you ask me. If you ask me. So yeah, you know what? At this point, I'll tap on done, it's getting annoying. But anyway, what I want to do is illustrate how that functionality works. If I take my time, it actually works really good. Right now, I'm not having good results. Maybe it's because I'm congested, but nonetheless. And you saw how I could quickly delete words. Just certain words. I don't know why it gives you only certain words you could delete. Perhaps it figures that these words are, you know, the chances of them being right are questionable. So for example, when I delete a word, oh, you also have suggestions. Ask me, asked. Oh, that's cool. So let's say, for example, good. It chose good. The probability was, chances are, the word I was looking for was good. But what if it wasn't? It gives a good. Maybe it was a good I was looking for. So I could tap that. And if it's wrong, I could just delete it. And when I delete it, my cursor is right there, so I could type in the missing word. Really, really useful. Okay, I'm going to quit my email. Message saved as draft. Let me show you some app termination. Let's try to do it through the... Whoopsie, not there. Through the battery. That was wicked. I like that. Battery. Email's taking up so much. Kill you. Browser, you're taking up too much. Kill you. Easy Wi-Fi keeps on coming back. Easy Wi-Fi. Maps, you go away. You not welcome. And let's refresh this deal. Easy Wi-Fi, why are you back? I thought I ended you. End you. There you go. Gone now. Okay. Not that. Apps. Certain things, I have no idea what they are, so I won't go into it. Battery, we went into. Browser, we went into. Calculator works. Camcorder. Camcorder and camera, I won't do on-screen examples because, once again, unfortunately, they require a micro SD card before you could do anything. Same thing with downloading through the browser, which I think is ridiculous. You can't download files through the browser unless you have a micro SD card. You have 1 gig of storage, well, 1 gig available. You have 2 gigs of storage on the phone. Why won't they let you download? Why won't they let you take pictures? I could do all this with the internal memory on my Samsung Galaxy W. I could do this with the internal memory on my garbage hipstreet tablet. Why can't I do it on this phone? Inexcusable. Clock is your clock. Download shows your downloads. Easy Wi-Fi, as I mentioned, what it does is it scans around and tries to connect to open Wi-Fis. I don't like that functionality so much. Eco mode, I showed. Email, I showed. Facebook, I'll never show because I don't use Facebook. Flash player settings. Oh yeah, the flash player settings are governed through a website, which is unfortunate. You could adjust local storage and peer assisted networking. So that's just a URL shortcut. Gallery, way of showing your pictures. Google settings, part of the new Google Play. Graphics, another way to show your images and to set backgrounds and whatnot. Ice, don't know. It's some kind of contact list. Latitude, that's showing your where you are to your friends, which is obscene. Local shows things of interest in the local vicinity. Maps, let me touch on maps. Maps has some good things and some bad things. Of course, it's showing right where I am. I'll scroll away, because if I'm just sat a bit away, that'll make the difference, won't it? Sorry, it's loading. Prove my location, I'm gonna skip that for now. Hey, you know what? I've already shown it with my my GPS tutorial. What's the point? I can tap on this, it will... Oh no, please enable my location source, forget it. Anyway, but you tap on this and it zooms in exactly to where you are. You tap on it again and you have a rotating map that works with the compass that you can move your phone around and it'll show you which direction you're headed. That's fun. What bothered me about this is get directions. I love this. So I'm leaving from my work. Here we go. And I'm going to... H7E4P2. Here we go. This is the way I want to go. I have the choice of car, bus, bike, and walk. Great. We have a toll bridge where I live in Quebec. I don't like taking the toll bridge because the toll bridge is expensive. It costs roughly around $6 per cross. It's pointless. It doesn't save me much time. I could easily drive my old routes. What's my options? Reverse start and end. On the old Google Maps, on all Google Maps prior to this one, I could set that. Now I can't. Of course, this option won't show that. Let me show you a for sure option. Hey, you were right there. Come on. Tap on. And I want to go to... Saint-Laurent? No. I want to go to Saint-Leonard. Leonard. Tiens. For sure. Get directions. What does it want me to do? It wants me to take that godforsaken bridge via Autoroute 25. I tap on it. I want to change it. Come on, give me options. I don't want Autoroute 25. I want something else. No. Brings you back here. Reverse start and end. There's no way to change that. And since most of the directions I map out are going on the island of Montreal, guess what? Hey, we'll send you on the toll bridge over and over and over. No way to change it. That's obnoxious. That is bloody obnoxious. Directions list, as usual. You could go left and right, change your directions. Here is a breakdown. Map view, that's fun. Everything works as I expect the Google Maps app to work. Nothing new. Although sometimes it's sending me off. I don't know why. Why did the compass... Oh yeah, because I rotated the map somewhat. Yeah, I could rotate the map. Wow. Alright, could also navigate. I won't bother showing it. Very cool. What you can do now, back in the day, the way the... Am I doing a zoom function somehow? Who knows? Anyway, the way it used to work back in the day, I don't know what's going on. Maybe it's because my fingers are moist, because once again, it's a hot day, and I'm sweating through my hands, I don't know. Anyway, back in the day, you'd have to, in order to pre-cache map tiles, as they're known, so by which you can take your map away from a data connection, used to have a functionality in labs called cache map tiles. And the way it used to work is you used to choose a predetermined square, a predetermined size of square. And you used to hold it and say, yes, cache this, yes, cache this. And you could tile a bunch of tiles covering your route. They've changed that. They've made it better. Will I be able to do it, or am I stuck in directions? Okay, that's working great. Come on, come on. Get out of here. Why won't you leave? There's some nonsense going on. Huh. I am stuck in maps. What if I do this? That is so bizarre. Sleep, wake. There we go. I don't know, that was some funny business. Let's go kill maps, shall we? I'm gonna go kill maps. You die. Okay. Well, that was worrisome. Anywho, okay. Let's try this again. Google. Yeah, it's fine. Okay, so, as I was saying prior, back in the day, the way it used to work is for map tiles, you would have to cache map tiles, and it was always a predetermined map. Oh, it's back to these damn directions. Okay. Here we go. Make available offline. This is the functionality. And you see, pan and zoom to select area. Now, the estimated size is 2 megs, but what I've learned is that the size can really go up. I was going to the South Shore a few days ago when I was testing GPS functionality, and you could see where I... Was this the one I chose? No, I chose a different one. Anyway, and I pan and zoomed, and the size changed. The size of the file changed in no time. It went from like 2 megs to 44 megs. And my data, my internet connection, not data, isn't very quick, so it took some long time. For example, this is the large area. Now it's saying 17, but this doesn't really make sense, because I went down, I did around that, maybe a bit more. No, it wasn't that far. See, there we go. Estimated size, 36 megs. It can really get heavy. And back in the day when I just used to cache map tiles, it was nowhere as long and as heavy as that. Oh, wow. Selected area too large. Please zoom in. Anyway, but by doing so, what I'm going to be doing is, in effect, I'm not just going to be taking like a screenshot of this map as it is now. It's also going to take note of all the little roads, all their names, and all that stuff. All the Google Map goodness stuff. Let's get a... This is less than one meg. Let's get this. Let's see if it works. Done. It just says failed. So funny. Error loading map. Tap to download. I can tell you why it failed, by the way. It's because I don't have an SD card in. Do you want to cancel the SAS? No. 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 Resume. Resume. Queued for download. Go away. Cancel. Yes. Start. Home. Work. Recent. Oh, I shouldn't show that. My maps. Checked in. Anywho. But yeah. If I had a micro SD card installed, I could do that. When it comes to the Navigate portion, Google Navigate, which is an extension of Google Maps, here's the thing. Back in the Android 2 days, I was able to use it to go roughly 7 kilometers and my map would remain intact. After 7 kilometers without a data connection, your maps get super fuzzy and it's hard to make out where you're going. Also, rerouting. With the old Google Navigate back on Android 2, when it came to rerouting, generally you could go pretty far off the beaten path and it would still reroute you even without data connection. No longer. Rerouting works very poorly. Rerouting for small little missteps, it'll do it. However, for larger missteps, let's say a difference of 3 minutes of driving, 4 minutes of driving, it won't do it. It'll just and freeze and go stupid. Now, the problem with that is on the old Google Maps Navigate, you'd have a rotating icon and it would say, what would it say? Would it say rerouting? Anyway, it would be a rotating indicator, and your screen would fade out. So you knew you were out of luck at that point if you were too far off the beaten path. On this, it doesn't do that. What it does is it says rerouting at the top, and the map... How can I put this? Moves fakely, if that makes any sense. You have your little vehicle indicator, your little arrow, and it's moving on a map, and you see it moving, but the map kind of does this. Clip, 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 clip. And never goes past, and never, you know, progresses. And it's really unfortunate. I've had experiences where the, bear with me, the Navigate portion, whereas I used to get 7 kilometers of coverage before my maps used to go fuzzy, if I go off the beaten path, I might have 2 kilometers at max before my maps go fuzzy, and in this case, they skip, so they're completely useless. Google Maps Navigate used to be I think, really useful, especially if for those who didn't have a persistent data connection from their provider. Now, the Navigate portion without a data connection is not very impressive at all. It's as if they went two steps back. I'm not impressed with that at all. Anywho, let's see if we could do some street view on camera. Gotta find a business or something. See all I see at Saint-Laurent? No street view here? Street view. What's new in street view? Just to show you what street view looks like. Once again, another program that's plagued by not wanting to rotate. You have to open up the slider in order to rotate. But here you go. Street view works very well. Let's show warping around. Go, Pigman, go! Give her. There you go. Perfect example. Let's see it in landscape view. There we go. Let's go down Boulevard de la Côte Vertu. Give her! There you go. And there you go, that's Street View. Street View works very well, despite the relative low resolution of the screen. Where was I? Okay, so we covered maps. Messaging I won't touch. Navigation I talked about. People, contactless phone, don't know about. Play Store works as the Google Play Store should. Public mobile's just a link to public mobile website. Settings I went over. Siren I'll get to. Text Plus and YouTube. Let's do some YouTube, shall we? YouTube trending. Rodney Dixon at yahoo.com. I already looked for myself. Ha ha ha. Let's get something with... I didn't put this. Anyway. Get something with video. Loaded. I should mention that the... Oh, here it is. Right in time. I should mention that I find the Wi-Fi reception and the speed of download of the Wi-Fi is noticeably slower on this device, and it's really unfortunate. I'm used to much quicker speeds for Wi-Fi download, and we're talking even my 600 megahertz phone and whatnot does better than this. Let's get some landscape going. Let's get some volume. You could hear the loudspeaker. I find that the resolution of YouTube videos is not, is fuzzy, it's pixelated. Once again, that could be due to the 480 by 320 resolution screen. But nonetheless, it does do the job. And finally, Siren. Siren, I'll just give you a little overview. It's a public mobile program, if you will. And in order to use it, you have to pay for the service. Now, real quick, on public mobile. Public mobile is available in Greater Montreal area and Greater Toronto area, for those who care. They offer unlimited incoming and outgoing phone calls. That's at the $45 plan a month. That's Canada and US wide. Completely free any time of the day. Well, included in your price. Any time of the day, as much as you want, provided you are in the Greater Montreal or Greater Toronto area. They also, you know, they offer things like three-way calling, caller ID, and things of that nature. Unlimited 3G data, incoming and outgoing. Well, incoming and outgoing goes without saying, but unlimited 3G data, so you could be on the internet all day, no problem, with never paying extra fees. Once again, provided you stay within the Greater Montreal area or Greater Toronto area. The reason I say that is because if you leave those areas, then it goes on a different system, that so you can't use your public mobile plan, you got to use a different plan. Anywho, but Siren, the way Siren works is on the $45 plan, they offer, the best way I could put it is kind of like an iTunes store. So you have access to full albums, singles, a large library of artists and music styles and what have you. But the difference between Siren and iTunes is Siren is included in your $45 a month plan. So essentially, it's a buffet of music. You can download as much albums as you want, as much songs as you want. You could download all day and night, and you're never paying anything aside from the $45 you're paying for your phone service a month. So that is pretty nifty. Now, I called Public Mobile and I talked to a representative about Siren, and what he tells me, I cannot vouch for this being completely accurate or completely true, but this is what he told me. The music, apparently, you can transfer it to other devices, such as a computer, which would lean to believe that the music is DRM-free. From what he tells me, from what this representative told me, the music is in MP3 format, and if you ever terminate your Public Mobile subscription or change your subscription type, you keep the music and the music continues to work. So if that is the case, that is pretty nifty. Unfortunately, like I said, you have to be on the $45 a month plan in order to use Siren. I am not, so I could not play with it. So there you go. Overall, what I have to say is the ameliorations of certain things, like the way the phone governs what apps run, how they run in the background, the ability to kill apps quickly, the ability to, what's the term? I'll use the correct term. The ability to not keep activities is great. The background process limit is awesome. Just, there's a lot of things that are really, really interesting. The fact that I don't have to unlock my screen each time, I love that. Problem is, I found the phone, despite its specs, first of all, the screen, despite being 3.5 inches, which is fine, it's better than 3.2, is the resolution's low. The tapping is not, you know, always super accurate. It's fine, but, you know, with a higher resolution screen comes more accurate tapping. Picture, that could be improved upon, of course. Keyboard's great. I love the keyboard. I love its functionality. Camera, I should have mentioned this. I apologize. It can do, I'll mention videos. Photos, it does 3.2 megapixel, it's fine. The flash is useless. The flash makes everything washed out in a pale blue. It's, unless you're taking pictures, for example, under your car or in your car engine bay to see things you need to repair, the pictures, in my opinion, are useless because they're all in that pale blue hue. It's ugly if you're using flash. Without flash, the 3.2 megapixel cameras or photos are fine. The video is interesting because it captures, despite only having a 3.2 megapixel camera, it captures video in 720 by 480 and 800 by 480, which are very impressive resolutions. Problem, of course, is that it doesn't do over 11 frames a second. It does between 10 and 11 frames a second of video. So that is sadly... See, in French we say décevant, but I can't use that. I can't use that in English. It's disappointing. That goes without saying. Google Maps, the ability to cache whole map areas is interesting, but I find it, once again, French term, gourmand, I find it, it takes a lot of storage space in order to do so. So that's unfortunate. I found just caching map tiles worked better. The navigation functionality is almost useless. The navigate functionality is almost useless if you don't have a data connection. Sorry. Email. The email app works fine. I find it to be... Can I say ugly? I find it to be not simplistic, but the layout isn't very attractive. I don't like the fact that I can't pinch zoom out of images very good. very well. At all. Sorry. Should clear that up. Browser's fine. Browser, you know, the requesting desktop site is fun. I like that. I like the tab structure. I didn't like the phone's use of Adobe Flash. I find it clunky on Adobe Flash. Once again, Adobe Flash not included on the phone. You gotta download it. Yeah, I think that pretty much covers... Oh, hey, I didn't touch this. Widgets, sorry. In settings, you have widgets. And you could choose the widgets you wish to add to your home screens. Analog clock, bookmarks, contact direct dial, direct message, directions and navigations, eco mode, email, email account, fetch a book, photo gallery, play store, power control, setting shortcut, and traffic. Oh, and YouTube. Anywho, but that's fun too. It's all fun. I don't like the layout of the soft buttons. I don't like menu or settings being to the far right and back being to the far left. It's confusing to me, who usually uses Samsung phones, who's a big fan of Samsung. But nonetheless, the phone, for what it is, especially if you're on public mobile, I think it's a fair price alternative. There is that 4.3 inch screen phone, which looks interesting. But I could tell you, this phone, compared to the ZTE N762, this phone is much more attractive. The ZTE is very low spec, so who knows how well that is. As mentioned, the QWERTY keyboard is brilliant. I love its layout. I love that Google voice typing functionality, much better than the good old Google voice search of old. I love eco mode. That's great. That works brilliantly. What I don't like is this integration. Activate your phone. There's no way to get rid of that. Since we're on CDMA here, I mean, of course, I put on airplane mode, so it's not communicating with the cell towers and what have you. But being proprietary to public mobile, that'll always bother you. I always want you to activate it. And once you activate it, it'll want to communicate. I mean, look, it is primarily a mobile phone, yeah? But there you go. That is my review. So, a fairly priced phone. Good hardware specs. However, not terribly performant. Good layout of the operating system. However, if I had the choice, I'd probably go back to Android 2, believe it or not. Android 2 in a Samsung variant, the way it's laid out, is much better in my opinion. However, this still has a lot of advantages that the Android 2 platform does not. Anyway, aside from me blowing my nose and suffering from allergies, which I apologize for again, I hope this information helps, and as usual, all the best.